All right, welcome to GeekWire, everybody, from GeekWire.com in Seattle. I'm Todd Bishop.
And I'm John Cook.
Hey, we are live on location here this week. We are recording on location here this week at the Microsoft store in Bellevue Square in front of another great audience. It's great to have all of you here. Absolutely. We've got a great show lined up for you this week, and thanks to Microsoft for hosting us here at Bellevue Square. They're in the midst of their 12 days of deals at the Microsoft store, so this place is hopping. A big thanks to all of you joining us in person for this special recording. We love our readers and listeners, and it's great to see so many of you in person. And we've got a big show lined up for you. In the news segment, we're going to be discussing lots of things, including a new startup that wants couples to bet on whether or not their marriages are going to succeed with a very unique loan arrangement that they've arranged.
Plus, Leave it to the Seattle entrepreneurs to come up with that one.
That's right. Plus, we'll be discussing a new carpooling service from Uber and Donald Trump's plan to close up the internet. Because, you know, that's possible.
Yes, the internets. As
the internet. The internets. And later on, we'll be talking with Panos Panay, the head of surface computing at Microsoft, for a deep dive on the company's hardware initiatives. Plus, for those listening on the radio show and podcast, we'll also be doing a special version of our GeekWire trivia challenge with a chance to win a great prize from Microsoft, a Microsoft Band 2.
Yeah, that's a great prize. I don't even know what the trivia question is this week, so we'll see if you can stump me.
I've got it lined up, exactly.
Okay.
Good deal. So stick around for a great show, but first, it's our weekly news roundup, The Week in Geek. So this is where some of the magic of the radio comes in. Because later on, we go back and we put in the actual sound. And we have a sound that our former producer, Aaron Rose, put together that's kind of a fun bumper for the Week in Geek. So that's what we'll be doing later. All right, John, so it was a big week for tech news. I think people are getting out all of their news here before the holidays come up. One of the most interesting news stories of the past week was a service from Uber called Uber Hop. And the reason that we found this so fascinating, for one thing, is Seattle continues to be the Peoria, the testing ground, for a lot of these new services, whether it's from Amazon or Uber or countless other tech companies. Companies are saying, hey, if it can work in Seattle, chances are it can work someplace else. And so that is what we saw with Uber Hop. Our colleague Taylor Soper covered this very thoroughly and actually broke the news. Uber Hop is essentially a carpooling service in the form of the Uber app.
Yeah, in fact, you know, Uber has gotten criticized as not truly being ride sharing. It's more ride hailing. In this case, it actually is ride sharing because you're showing up at a designated location. I think there are about four or five different locations around Seattle.
Right, just three routes.
Just three
to start
routes.
Out with.
And you can jump into an Uber with a few of your pals or people that aren't your pals and get a ride to a destination. So I know there's Fremont to downtown Seattle, which is of interest to us since our headquarters are in Fremont.
That's
right.
But
I think this is a fantastic idea. I'm excited to try it.
The routes were actually interesting, and only people here in the Seattle region will appreciate this, but it goes Ballard to South Lake Union, Fremont and Capitol Hill to downtown. Why they did it that way, I'm not sure, but I think there must be some large population of Amazon workers in Ballard. My neighbors in Ballard all work for
perhaps,
Amazon.
Yeah,
is that what's going on?
But it's just $5, right?
Right. A flat $5
fee. Which is pretty interesting business model. And Taylor Soper on our team had a follow-up story talking about this and the economics of it. And a lot of the economists that he talked to said they thought this was going to be a viable model. So I don't know if our listeners out there in the Microsoft store land think this is a good idea or not, but $5 a pop and you can get out them seeing some thumbs up from the audience.
But by a show of applause, who would try Uber Hop? Oh, show of hands. Okay.
Show of hands, yeah.
Some people would try it out.
Yeah.
$5, it's an interesting concept at least. You do kind of, I'm sure, get into some uncomfortable situations where if you're on a bus, you know, you can walk to the other end. If you're in a car, you're in trouble if you get somebody that you don't want to be riding with.
Yeah, I would maybe think that the clientele of Uber maybe has a slightly different clientele or
no,
customer experience
I'm not
than
talking
on the city
about,
bus.
I'm not talking about anything like that. I'm thinking more just somebody who would talk your ear off or somebody that
Well,
might...
it's like the person on the airplane that won't stop talking.
That's
okay.
right. It's exactly
Are you
exactly
antisocial
right.
or something? What's your problem?
Yeah, pretty much, okay. as you can tell.
All right.
All right, so that was UberHop. I will link from the show notes to all of our coverage about that. As we said, our colleague Taylor Soper has been all over that. So let's talk about this startup that got the big laugh. It's called Swan Love. And here's from our story about this particular startup. It's based in Seattle, so there is true innovation happening here in Seattle.
Right.
Essentially, they're offering a way for couples to gamble on whether or not they really found everlasting love. So if you go to them, you get a loan for the cost of your wedding, a loan up to $10,000, and if you and your spouse stay married forever, you never have to pay the loan back. But if you do get divorced later on, then this is part of your divorce costs, essentially. You're going to be paying them the loan back with interest. And it's fascinating to me because the company actually studies the couples and sets
oh,
the
right.
interest rate.
So does it reject couples?
In some cases, it looks like it does.
Okay, so if they see a really strong match here, they're just not going to participate.
Right, so this is one case where if you, in fact, do not qualify to take advantage of this startup services, maybe it's a good thing because maybe it means that your marriage is actually going well.
Yeah, or maybe you go in and fake it and you have a big argument while you're getting evaluated, and then you can get the $10,000 in costs.
Even at that point of your relationship, could you fake true love? I would have had a hard time doing that. I think true experts, which apparently these folks at Swan Love are, can really suss out whether a relationship is going to succeed or not. Am I off base on that?
I don't know. This is going to be a fun startup to watch, though. Yeah,
so it's a startup called Swan Love, and the CEO is named Scott Avey, and it'll be a really good one to talk about. All right, let's talk about the elephant in the room, Donald Trump. And just so we know who we're going to offend with this next segment, does anybody want to acknowledge that they're planning to vote for Donald Trump here in the audience at the Microsoft store? Nobody? Okay, good. We got one person. I think they're joking. What about you, John? Do you plan to vote for Mr. Trump?
He's an interesting character. There was just a poll that came out saying that like 35% of Republicans support Trump, the most that he's polled at. Now, this came out before he made his
comment about
not allowing any Muslims into the country.
Yep.
Certainly would probably have an impact on his poll numbers. But
that's right.
But he's been in the news here with a lot of tech CEOs in the Seattle area. What was he saying about Microsoft co-founder Bill Gates?
That's right. So the idea, Donald Trump's idea, because because people are getting radicalized through their communication with the Islamic State over the internet, his idea is basically to close up the internet so those people won't get radicalized or be inclined to align themselves with terror groups. And actually, we have a clip. Let's listen right now to what he said. And now I'll read it for you. He said, "We're losing a lot of people because of the internet, and we have to do something. We have to go see Bill Gates and a lot of different people that really understand what's happening. We have to talk to them, maybe in certain areas, and closing up the internet in some way might be smart." What do you think?
Well, I love how like anytime there's a technology challenge, like Bill Gates gets thrown out as like the savior to like come in and fix things.
Yeah,
isn't that kind of funny?
It is a little weird. Actually, if Trump actually knew what he was talking about, which obviously we're nowhere near that place, but if he did, Elon Musk would be a much more natural person to say, "Hey, this guy could solve all of our problems. I mean, he's fixing energy, he's fixing cars, he's getting us to space, and he's sending us to Mars. I mean, this is the guy who could potentially, if anybody in the tech industry could, come up with a solution to terrorism,"
yeah,
right?
The other thing that's kind of funny about Donald Trump in recent weeks, I don't know, I think we need to do a story on this at GeekWire. He has taken either battles or made references to three of the main technology CEOs or founders in the Seattle region. He's gotten into a Twitter battle with John Legere, the CEO of T-Mobile, which dates back about 6 or 8 months when John Legere was saying he hated the Trump hotel he was staying in. Then you had Jeff Bezos saying that he wanted to send Donald Trump to outer space. This with Bill Gates and fixing this internet thing that's going to be kind of big. So
I thought Jeff Bezos' response to Donald Trump was one of the best things that Jeff Bezos has ever said publicly.
It was only like his third or fourth tweet, wasn't it?
It was. So they were in a bit of a Twitter spat, and Bezos' only response was, "Finally trashed by the real Donald Trump. We will... We'll still reserve him a seat on the Blue Origin rocket." And the hashtag was, "Send Donald to space, presumably never to come back." Maybe like an early test flight we could put him on.
Yeah.
That'd be good. All right, so that was Donald Trump. Big news week. Any other thoughts on the week as we're sitting here talking with the folks here at the Microsoft Store?
No, getting ready to head into the holidays, and it's going to be a fun one.
This probably won't make it on the radio show because we're already over time for the news segment, but I've got to share. I went on vacation in Lake Tahoe over Thanksgiving, and I spent a lot of time in the arcades with my daughter. And there is one arcade game that's similar to a TV game show, Deal or No Deal. Has anybody ever seen the arcade game for Deal or No Deal? Well, there was a young girl in that arcade who was winning 2,000, 4,000 tickets at a time on Deal or No Deal. And I saw what was going on, and I went up to her and I said, "How are you doing this? What's your secret?" Her kid brother was sitting next to her. And at the beginning of Deal or No Deal, there's this moment where all the cases jumble up and it moves too fast. But if you can track it, you know what these kids did? And you know why? This is for me a sign that the future is actually okay. They were recording it in slow motion on their phone and playing it back, and they were winning every single time. And for me, this is the greatest sign I've seen this holiday season of the hope for the future of humanity, that these kids figured this out. I just had to share. That's
nice
all.
Nice story time.
All
good
right.
Holiday moment.
All right. We will be right back around the corner. We are at the Microsoft Store in Bellevue Square this week. Coming right up, we'll have Panos Panay, the head of surface computing at Microsoft, answering all of our tough questions here on GeekWire on Cairo Radio, 97.3 FM.
There we go. Thanks. Yeah.
Nice.
Let us hear it.
I will say that is the first time we've ever gotten applause. All right, welcome back to the Microsoft Store at Bellevue Square Mall, everybody, from GeekWire.com in Seattle. I'm Todd Bishop.
And I'm John Cook.
Do that clean.
And I'm John Cook.
All right, we are here this week at the Microsoft Store. Thanks to Microsoft for sponsoring this event and hosting the giveaway. No. We want you. We want you guys, not John.
Okay. If I got to be honest, that feels kind of weird.
No.
I do this a lot. Andrew like, can attest to that. He's been on.
We should say Andrew Edwards is here. He is the person on the show who's been on
more
than any other.
Yes.
Andrew, you know what, Andrew? Why don't you come take my spot? Because
we should tease that. Yes.
Wow.
All right. Our guests on the show this week, we've got a twofer, a surprise guest, along with Panos Panay. He is the head of surface computing at Microsoft, the corporate vice president in charge of Surface and other key hardware products for Microsoft. Panos, it's great to have you here.
Thanks, man. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely.
Thanks,
it's our pleasure.
Yeah, I'm excited.
And as well, Stevie Bathiche. He is a distinguished scientist in the hardware division at Microsoft, longtime mainstay at Microsoft. We really have the brains, two of the big brains here behind Microsoft's hardware initiative. So it's great to have you both on the show.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, man.
Good deal. So, Panos, let me tell you what my external perception of Microsoft's hardware strategy is these days, and I want to get a sense for whether this is correct.
Yeah, no, let me write it down so I have one, too.
Okay, all right. So Microsoft's hardware strategy now is not to be comprehensive. You're not trying to make every single type of device.
Yeah.
The strategy is to look at the landscape of devices and say, hey, what is not being done that should be done, and how can Microsoft do something that solves a customer need and, by the way, plays to the strengths of Windows and your own strengths as a company. Is that correct?
I think I would say, yeah, I think it's as close. It is about customers. It's about people and what they need, what they can do. And it is about Windows, but not just Windows. It's all across Microsoft. That's a big deal. Like, how do we bring everything across Microsoft together to create these experiences that people would love and want to use every day and make their lives richer and better? I think we put our energy there. And yeah, you are right. We don't play everywhere. I don't think we intend to. We really think and focus on the premium aspects of products and making sure that what we're giving people is delightful in that sense as well.
Okay, that's great. So Panos, you yourself have had a change in your role in just the past few months. It's gone from just the Surface and the Surface Book to also include the phone hardware. So as you look at the market for smartphones, thinking about that approach, that strategy that you're taking, what needs to be done in smartphones that isn't being done now? Where's your opportunity?
It's always the leading question. I'll tell you right now. It starts with making sure we're putting products in people's hands that people love. You know, you see that today with what we're doing with our Surface devices. You've seen a little bit of that with the new Lumia products for sure. People are pretty excited about it. We have a lot to offer and a lot to do, but I don't want to get trapped into the here's what the next thing is, because that's not exactly where I'll go.
Trap? What trap? It's just a question.
I will tell you though. Yeah, don't. Stevie, you.
Stevie, you can weigh in. It's all right.
Panos is doing just fine.
Okay, so I'll just ask it. So, yeah. So are you working on a Surface phone?
And people love asking that. I mean, and again, you know, nice try. It's a good one. I think you have to continuously check the landscape of what needs to happen next in all our device categories. Okay. So important. And so, you know, we work on a lot of stuff.
Okay.
We work on a lot of stuff.
And you can't give any, but you do oversee phones now. Does that
absolutely
mean, does
yeah,
that
yeah
mean, yeah, so does that mean you're overseeing the Lumia line or something else?
Yeah, so right now the Lumia line is exactly what it is. And we have the Surface line and we have every other device that the company makes. And it really is about bringing them all together with a consistent feeling and making sure the experiences across Microsoft come to our customers.
So one of the most interesting stories, and actually, Stevie, do you want to jump in on that? Where do you see the opportunity? And I'm really not trying to trap you, but what are the big challenges out there that you're facing?
Different way to ask it.
Yeah.
Fair.
In regards to Surface and phone?
Or just anywhere, hardware in general.
Making the beautiful trade-offs that encompasses hardware, software, and experiences, and making sure that transcends, the whole device experience.
What does that mean exactly?
Meaning when you decide to put something on a hardware device or don't decide to put something on a hardware device, that you have the operating system and the applications that we're making in perspective as well, and that's something that we are really excited about at Microsoft and continually do.
Okay. So Panos, John and I left our MacBooks at home out of respect. I've got my Surface 2 here, and we can talk about that a little bit later on.
All right,
but
I see it.
I imagine there's lots of folks out there who are using other types of Windows PCs, other types of Windows notebooks.
Yeah.
What would be your pitch to them on the Surface Book? Why should somebody really look at the Surface Book?
First off, if somebody's using a Windows PC, I'm super happy. I think that's a great thing. And they're using it for a reason, and there's a great experience that comes with it, and I think that's important. I think if you're looking at Surface Book, it's just pushing it a little bit further. If you're a creator and you want to create something with a pen, where you want to be able to walk away from the entire experience of the laptop and encompass yourself in a different environment, whether it be physical or emotional, I think that detached moment is an important one. And then being able to put ink to that pixel has become so important for us. We've watched it, man. We've seen people who didn't believe in writing on screens, and now it's becoming more ubiquitous. And you're seeing that in and out. And I think if that's what you want to do, I think you're going to find the best experience possible to drive emotion into your product.
So what's been the reaction by other hardware makers to your introduction of the Surface Book, your first real attempt at a laptop?
I don't know, man. I've seen quotes, so I can't articulate exactly. Other hardware makers, it's not like my head's in the sand or anything, but at the same time I'm not seeking it out. I will tell you, we've gotten a lot of compliments, we've gotten a lot of love for doing what we did, and you have no idea how flattering that is, because we took a product that we didn't actually think we could make when we started, you know, 3 years ago, and we looked hard at it and said, man, this is a huge leap of what we're trying to accomplish.
Why was it so hard? That's a great point.
There were so many things to make sure that it was a full laptop first, and nobody was confused about that, and that we didn't end up with some what we called clickety-clack mechanism, it's the way our team talks, or something where it was an obvious trade-off that had to be made, where it wasn't this full, you know, lappability experience or this full laptop feel. And so as we looked at that going through and how we would separate out the GPU if we wanted to go for that performance, that took a while, you know, and it took Windows 10 to get us there. It took a lot of hardware innovation. You're looking at wall thicknesses on a product that have never really been achieved before with the materials that we use, ever. And that takes evolution and time. So when we first started, we thought, man, there's a chance we can get there. And then, you know, it is this spirit of relentlessness, or I think you hear Satya talk about growth hacking. I think that's in our DNA, where we literally go after it, and if we can't see the end, we keep going until we can, and I think that came to life pretty quick.
Yeah, Stevie Bathiche, do you want to weigh in on the design challenges and how you overcame them?
Yeah, I mean, the one of the things that we're really excited about and proud of in the Surface Book was the screen. 1500 to 1 contrast ratio, super high. Beautiful colors. You look at it, sometimes when we look at the book, we are not sure if it's actually a prototype or a real unit. That's how beautiful the picture looks like, because, you know, is this a piece of paper that you printed out and stuck it on the book, or is this actually the screen that you're looking at live? And that's very rewarding to build a product like that in that form factor that has such a high performance screen, which takes, you know, it demands space, power, and performance, but yet we didn't compromise the product.
So when you look at the Surface Book from the front, when it's open, it looks great. I mean, but for people who aren't used to it, if you look at it from the side, the hinge is articulated, and because that's one of the mechanisms that you're using to keep it up and then still allow the tablet portion to be taken out. And then there's a gap when the notebook is closed. How did you end up with that? And what do you say to people who might be wary of the Surface Book because of it?
So you have, it's interesting that you asked the question. You know, early on, it depends on who you asked about it and how you told the story of the Surface Book and what it did. We don't design products for just pure aesthetic purpose. Like, this will look beautiful and look awesome, and so then what's the product that it should be? We won't do that. In other words, we have these conversations in our labs continuously, which is, what is the purpose of this? And if the purpose is there and the person using it appreciates the purpose, that the question goes away very quickly. Like, why does it look like it goes away quickly? I think from a distance you can look at it and it looks different. We use words like economic, we use words that are totally made up, like labability, where we have definitions in our labs for how we think about when somebody sees it, will they know it's a Surface? And I think when you look at a Surface Pro 4 or a Surface Pro 3 or a Surface 2 in front of you, you can identify very quickly when that kickstand pops out and there's a story that comes with it. There's also fit and finish and lines that are consistent, that are recognizable. You might not be able to identify them when you look, but you'll feel them. And I think Surface Book took some of those lines, but we also created its own kind of look to it, which was so important to us. And so far it's been endearing, it's been nice. And you know, at the launch event we talked a little bit about the dynamic fulcrum, we talked a little bit about that hinge that you're talking about. I think we probably could have spent 4 hours on it, and yeah. You know, we gave it a minute and a half in the talk track, and I think you want me to talk for 4 hours on the hinge, I could do that for you.
All right, well, we're out of time here in the first segment with Panos Panay. Sorry, that was a joke. We are actually out of time.
Yeah, good.
But we're going to be right back around the corner. Go ahead.
No, go, man. No, this is your show. Sorry.
All right, we are here at the Microsoft store in Bellevue Square. We're talking with Panos Panay, the head of Surface Computing at Microsoft, and Stevie Bathiche, a distinguished scientist in Microsoft's hardware group. And we will be right back with more on Cairo Radio 97.3 FM. All right, welcome back. We are recording this week at the Microsoft store in Bellevue Square.
Come on down. You got to go to the Microsoft store, people.
Studio audience here.
I love, by the way, you have no idea, I'm such a huge fan. When we started Surface,
By the way, this is Panos Panay.
Sorry.
Head of devices at Microsoft here. Go for it, Panos.
The Microsoft stores were, it was all about trying to, you know, we were learning years ago, 3 years ago. Is it three years now? Yeah. At least in market. And just the learnings in opening the stores and watching the stores grow and bringing our products to life together has been pretty spectacular. So being here is a joy for me.
That's great. Yeah. So Panos or Stevie, do you guys watch a lot of NFL football?
Yeah.
You do.
Yeah, it turns out I've got a problem with that.
Yes.
My wife tells me, like, I work a lot. I spend a lot of time with my kids. And then when football's on and I'm home, that's pretty much the only thing I get to do.
So for those who haven't followed this, Microsoft did a large sponsorship deal with the NFL. I think it was $400 million for Surface to get Surface on the sidelines. And it's been a bit of a mixed blessing because you've got all the advertising there. It says Microsoft Surface right in front of everybody there on the sidelines. And then the announcers have taken to calling them things like iPad-like devices.
Oh man!
It seems like you can't really. It seems like you can't really catch a break. What have the internal mails been like on that? Who's gotten in trouble?
Look, seriously, it takes time. Like, people are learning this brand, and it's starting to really pop now. It's fun, and of course, you know, there's going to be the iPads out there. It's full speed. It's, you know, wonderful device for many people. And when they say it, that's all right. I think we correct it as best we can, of course, and you don't hear that much anymore. You don't hear it at all, really. You hear people understanding, look, this is Surface, and it's more productive, and it does more, and it allows you to get more done. And I think people are starting to see it, including the NFL. I mean, we have it on the sideline, and it's such a joy to watch the players use it. It's unbelievable.
That's great. So what do you think of the iPad Pro?
I think it's what am I supposed to tell you about the iPad Pro? Yeah, it's an interesting product for sure. That's my, you know.
So let me get you started here. There are a lot of similarities, you might say, to the Surface.
Yeah, sure, there are. I think a lot of people have called that out. I think people love to talk about it. I haven't used one. So I'm sorry, I don't
You're
have
kidding
the,
me.
No, I have not. I'm not, not.
Stevie, have you used one?
Briefly.
Okay. Yeah. What does that mean? You went into a store and tried one out?
Yes.
Okay. Also, we should say Stevie Bathiche, who is distinguished scientist in the hardware group, is here as well.
The comparisons are flattering in some sense. I mean, there's a lot of products out there that are happening similar to Surface. I think there's a category that's been created here. I think it's fun to acknowledge that and see others acknowledging it as opposed to, you know, just saying it. It's been fun. I think we've seen a lot of that, and it's good.
So what is the strategy for trying to catch up to the iPad or Apple with their big lead in the device market, and specifically in tablets?
I think our focus is not about anything there. It's more about making sure people can be more productive and that they have an opportunity to buy a premium device that lets them do that. And bringing Microsoft assets and experiences together, that's huge for us. And so it's not, while the products can be complicated to make sure they're premium or the fit and finish is right, or, you know, we can tell any story about it, but ultimately we do have these wonderful, wonderful experiences across Microsoft that come together on these devices. So that part's fairly, you know, in tune and defined. Yeah. Feels good. Yeah.
So I think this is our last Apple question, but we've got to ask it.
Yeah, no, keep going. Let's talk about them all day.
So Apple CEO Tim Cook called the Surface Book diluted. Originally, the report was diluted, but then Apple actually issued a correction saying, no, he didn't say it was diluted. He said it was diluted.
Yeah.
In other words, it's trying to be too much, both tablet and laptop, and it's not the best of either. So what's your response to Tim Cook?
I think Tim's a great leader. I think he's a great leader. Everyone has an opinion, of course. And, you can argue about any product, I suppose, but...
Well, how about that in terms of the idea of combining a tablet with a laptop? I mean, I think that's the point that Tim Cook was trying to make, that it was trying to do too much. Do you think it is successful in hitting both being a great laptop and tablet?
Yeah, so that one's like a low-hanging curveball and when I used to play baseball, I think. But, I think it does. I think it does both extremely well. And, you know, if you pick up this device, you feel good using it. The feedback so far has been off the charts fun. And you do have that opportunity to really remove it and immerse yourself. You know, Stevie, in designing the screen in 3x2 and being able to hold it, it's not unwieldy at all. It feels great. I mean, it's a 13.5-inch screen, yet when you're holding it, it feels so comfortable and natural, and it's that shape of a piece of paper. I know that sounds like jargon, but it's not, man. That's what we designed, and it's familiar. And I think we've captured both. I think we've captured it. I feel good about it. And, you know, it comes down to if people believe that, and when they use it, do they love it? And so far, we're seeing very positive results there.
So over the years, Microsoft's been criticized about getting things out of the lab and into consumers' hands. And it seems like that might be transitioning here with where you see these products like Surface Book. Is there a new era in terms of getting the research out into consumers' hands?
I think we have so much to offer and create that we can bring to life through Microsoft, and that's true of the experiences across the board. This isn't just devices. And I think, you know, we're just really getting started, which is funny, right? And so many generations into Microsoft, but we really are. And so is it a new era or is it a continuation? I'm not sure what the right answer is, but I'll tell you, the passion and drive, and specifically on the teams that we get to work with day in and day out. Right. You look at a guy like Stevie who's here, where he's able to apply his mind to such amazing theoretical ideas and then bring them to real life. That's all happening. That's all happening real time.
So as Microsoft is making this transition, who's the tougher boss, Steve Ballmer or Satya Nadella?
Oh, man. Here's the deal. I'm absolutely not going to answer that question. I will say that both are, and I mean this, because they're both special to me, and they're both very different, but they're such great leaders. I will tell you, and they have very different attributes, as you well know. They speak differently, but I will tell you, they're both inspiring. If you get 5 minutes with either one of them, they blow your mind just in the inspiration.
Right.
And we've watched the company grow through all these years, and now we have Satya who's leading us, and he's so elegant and thoughtful. And you know, when we get to walk through the labs together, and he puts his hands on the products, and he has opinions, and he helps form these things. I mean, it's really delightful, man. It's super delightful and inspiring.
I would have answered Panos Panay for the tougher boss.
What kind of boss is Panos? Let's hear this, Stevie.
Tough boss.
In what way? Tell us like the
right, yeah.
Tell us like what the average day being managed by Panos is like.
Being with Panos is being with family for me, right? I've been working with Panos since the day he walked into Microsoft, and it's been a beautiful journey, and I've been lucky along with other people that, you know, we've been on that ride together.
That's great. Yeah. I remember I saw you guys at another Microsoft store once, and you told a great story, Panos, about how the design of one of the original Surface kickstands was influenced by Steve Ballmer's slouching.
Yeah, no, right? It wasn't right? Slouching, man. It was laying on his back.
Laying on his back.
Tell that story.
Like this, dude.
Right, yeah.
Yes. Panos is now laying down.
He would literally. Oh,
there goes the thing.
Steve would literally yell at me. That's not the right words. He would literally come in and ask, "What if I want to lay on my back?" And I'm like, "Why would you lay on your back, Steve?" Yeah, we used to laugh about it. And no, the idea behind the kickstand was, it really was this, how is it that you were going to use it in the form where the laptop capability came to life? You know, we call this lapability, and there's been a lot of memes around that and so forth. But I will tell you that part of it is, if somebody uses their laptop laying on their back and typing, then we got to figure out how to make that kickstand come to life. I think generationally, we got there with Pro 3. I was pretty proud of that.
With the hinge that could be at essentially any angle.
Yeah, I mean, that's it goes back down to, I think, 150 degrees. So you literally can take any angle possible in any position you're in, and this thing will work for you just like a laptop.
Okay. So all right, we are talking this week with Panos Panay and Stevie Bathiche of Microsoft's hardware team. We're getting all the inside details, or at least as much as they're willing to talk about without pissing somebody off inside the company. And it's been great. We've got one more segment with them, and right around the corner, we are going to be giving away to one lucky listener on the show a Microsoft Band 2 in our next...
Oh, very cool.
In our next,
that's very cool.
In our next GeekWire Trivia Challenge. So stick around for that on the radio and on the podcast. You're listening to GeekWire from Cairo Radio, 97.3 FM. All right, it is time for the return of our GeekWire Trivia Challenge. First off, we are going to name the answer and the winner from last week's show. I don't know how many of you folks listened last week, but up for grabs was an Xbox One last week, and the question was, don't call her a princess. What will be Leia's new title in Star Wars The Force Awakens? Does anybody here in the audience at the Microsoft store know? General. That's right. That's right. A lot of people that are...
Is she a general now?
Yeah. General Organa, I think, is technically her new title. So,
oh, wow.
Congratulations to our winner, Jeff Gepner, who was chosen at random from the pool of correct answers to last week's challenge. Now, here is this week's challenge. And, John, you were joking earlier that you didn't know what the trivia question was going to be, so you wouldn't know the answer. But you're going to know this one. You're going to know this one. So... this is our new challenge out there. Up for grabs is a Microsoft Band 2, courtesy of our hosts here at Microsoft this week. From the pool of correct answers this week, we'll pick one person at random to win that prize. And we'll give you the details on how to submit in just a moment. So here is the question. Who said this? Turning around HP was relatively easy versus running for governor of California. Does anybody in the audience know that? We'll bleep it out afterward. All right, so once again, the question is, if you think you know the answer, send it to contest@geekwire.com. Once again, that's contest@geekwire.com. From the pool of correct answers, we'll pick one person at random to win a Microsoft Band 2, courtesy of our hosts here at Microsoft. And once again, the question is, who said this? Turning around HP was relatively easy versus running for governor of California. Send your answer to contest@geekwire.com. All right, we are here at the Microsoft store in Bellevue Square this week with our guests, Panos Panay and Stevie Bathiche from the Microsoft hardware team. It's been great to have both of you on the show. So, Panos, I'm here with my Microsoft Surface 2.
I see that.
Released 2 years ago.
That's
this thing
right.
still gets a ton of use in my house.
Yeah,
this is how
product.
We watch. It
that's
is a good product. So, I reached a point about 2 weeks ago where I was trying to install an app, the Sling TV app, on this device. And of course, there's no ARM app for Sling TV that I can run on this device.
Yeah.
So what do you say to those folks? Because this gets into all of the Windows RT, Surface RT, the version of Windows and the version of the Surface tablet that run on ARM tablets. Why did you guys lead all of us down this dead end? And where can I go from here other than buying a new Microsoft product?
Man, nice question. Here's the deal, man. That product still does what it's supposed to do for you. I mean, I think you can still use it as a great productivity device for sure, and there's apps on there that you can use and love. I think when you want to get to the next generation, then moving to Windows 10 is an important thing. Surface 3 came out to bring that to life and to give you more opportunity to go move towards that, and that's where we took the direction.
But will there be another version of the ARM-based Surface tablet, whether you call it something like Surface RT or Surface 4? Will there be another version of an ARM-based Surface tablet?
Answering the future question is not on the list of things to do, but I would tell you that what we'll continue to do is make you great Surface devices. I think that we both know.
Okay. Buzz Bruggeman here in the audience asked a great question during the break, and that was, do you think you've spurred the other hardware makers to do new things because of the advances that you've made in the Surface Book or the Surface Pro or any of the other tablets that you've done or devices?
I can tell you that one of the opportunities was to hopefully inspire others to think about the new categories and the devices we're creating for sure. I'm not sure I have any firsthand information that can tell you we have. I think there's a lot of designs out there that might be influenced, but not 100% sure. But you know, you look at it and go, yeah, I think people would come along if we made the right device and we created the right experiences. And we're seeing this category kind of take off a little bit right now, and that's a good thing. And I think Surface is one of the main drivers of that.
Okay. Would you like to see Android apps running on Surface tablets? And what's the status there?
I don't necessarily have a status. I think there's... We need to continue, and we are continuing to growing the Windows 10 apps that are coming out right now, the UAP apps that are out there, the things that people are needing and loving to do on their Surface. I think we have some pretty good traction.
So for people who may not be familiar, UAP means?
Just a universal app platform.
Yeah. This is the idea that you create one app, and it essentially runs across all Windows devices.
Yeah,
so that's really fun. It seems like that's where Microsoft is pinning its hopes.
For sure. We're seeing a lot of traction, too. We see a lot of good stuff coming out.
Yeah, but they're your kids. I know you've got four kids.
I do.
Four beautiful children. At one of the last events I saw you here at a Microsoft store, you actually had at least a couple of them with you.
Did I?
Or maybe it was Stevie's kids. I'm not sure.
It might have been Stevie.
Yeah. What do you learn about technology from your kids?
Oh, man.
And from watching them, what do you learn about where things are headed based on the user habits?
Christmas.
Oh. So my little Anna just submitted her Christmas list, and I was she's six, and she's a darling, and I didn't read it, and she's just learning to write. I literally got to work yesterday morning and pulled it out of my bag because I'm taking it, you know, to Santa, as you can imagine. And I pulled it out, and number one on the list, Surface Book. And then number two was Surface Pro 4. And so just to give you some context, I'm not sure she's living in reality as a six-year-old asking for a Surface Book, but, I mean, bless her for asking. I think, you know, it's watching them use devices, it really does. Now, listen, my kids span from 6 to 14, and there's four of them. And they all use the devices differently, and I watch them use their phones. In my house, they're able to choose any device that they want to use. It doesn't necessarily have to be a Surface device, just so you know. I mean, this is what they do. Now they've all kind of migrated to Surface over time, and watching them use it has given us unbelievable inspiration. I think Stevie and I, even when Stevie and I are hanging out of work hours, we'll talk about what the kids are doing right in front of us with the pen and what they're able to do. The capabilities that are coming right now are unreal for children. And it's funny because they're so whiz-bang. They work so fast on these devices relative to what I can accomplish. And so it is inspiring. So we do look at positions, how they're used, what apps are out there, and it's a very quick lead indicator on what's coming. And, you know, as they talk to their friends, you see that very quickly. And it's pretty inspiring for me when the kids are using it because they want to. And that's a big deal because you can imagine in my house we have a lot of test devices. When I say a lot, I mean one for every day of the week. So we're... You know, I'm always shuffling something, but when they just grab their own and they won't let it go, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. Well, and this is going to sound like I'm still trying to get you to talk about future product plans, but I'm not.
Yeah, okay, good.
Let me ask this question. If you were to look 2-3 years out at Microsoft's hardware business, what would success look like to you? What would be the measure of really turning things around and making Microsoft hardware really relevant across the culture?
Yeah, awesome. First off, man, people loving the devices is everything. It fuels so much when people love your devices. I mean, just like the people who making them have to love making them and put all their love into them, we want people to get all the love out of them when they use them. You know, this is such a big deal. I think that fuels everything. But what does it look like? It looks like growth in the categories we're creating. And that's it. And that's what we talk about. Like, we're going to go create categories. We want these categories to grow, and we're going to see them grow, and we're going to keep investing to make that happen.
So how much of... I saw your lot...
Okay. Go ahead, Stevie, on that one. Go.
Yeah, I mean, every new computing form factor is preceded by a new human-computer interaction model. And it's one of the things that we invest extremely heavily on in the company, from MSR to the hardware groups, to Windows, to our application services group, and to me, the success is innovating and creating those new categories, using that new interaction modality. And this is one of the things that we were really excited by with Surface, by incorporating, you know, the keyboard, the mouse, the touchscreen, and the pen all together in a device that allows and adapts to the user rather than the other way around. And in the future, you know, we hope to see more devices that, unlock new computing form factors that are unlocked by a new way of interacting with the machine.
Yeah, like what?
hard to be very specific, but
you have
things.
That, Stevie.
Well, I mean, there are obviously things that are on the horizon, like HoloLens. You know, obviously Band is helping create a new category. You have Cortana being a huge technology bet for the company that's voice enabled. So there are a lot of things here that are very natural, intuitive ways that people already know how to do, and computers are becoming more smarter and more aware, and that's really a big thing.
So Panos, I watched the launch video for the Surface Book, and you use words, and you're using them here today, such as love and beautiful and phenomenal. And it seems like there's a real effort just to change a perception around Microsoft hardware. How much of your job is just changing an age-old perception around the product, and how do you address that?
I don't think about it that way. Look, we have a lot of emotion that we put in these products, and people like using the word passion. This is just everyday real life. Like, that's what we're doing. I don't think that's in my job description at all. I think that's just what we're doing right now in the, you know, sometimes I use those words, but they're not necessarily calculated. They're how I feel. And I think it's important to reflect that into the products. And even when we talk about them, that's just, it's a little bit of who we are and where we're going. I think Satya has instilled Growth Hacker. I think Satya has instilled some beautiful attributes into the company, and he's inspired so much, and he's changed so much with his leadership in the company. And I think that's showing. And you have a guy like me or a person like Stevie who is completely motivated by not only Satya, but the opportunities that are ahead of us and where Microsoft is headed. I think that is, to me, where you see that fuel. Let me say it again. Like, these products can only be as good as the people that are making them, and they can only be as good as how much the people love making them and love what they're doing. And then you get that love out of the product. I think that's I know it's intangible. I totally get it. And it's almost somewhat, you know, it's theoretical almost. It's silly. You can even go that far. But I'll tell you, like, you when you see somebody using the product and they just absorbing it, I mean, there's a lot that went into it that they're taking out. I think that's just freaking cool.
That's great. So we're in the process of wrapping up here. Is there anything that you guys would want to get across that you haven't gotten across yet? We're talking with Stevie Bathiche and Panos Panay. What would you want people to know about your jobs, about Microsoft, things that might be misperceptions out there, anything that you want to get across?
I think we want people to use these devices. We want people to understand how it brings together that Microsoft ecosystem and then give us the feedback. Like, there's nothing I love more than when people use it, tell us how they feel, what they think. Man, we've been on this journey now with Surface in the making for 5 years. Stevie's been on it with me since day one. And, you know, as you watch those steps and the progress and just the evolution of the products, even from Surface 2 to Surface 3, as you pointed out, there's so much that has changed, but it all comes from our customers. It all comes from what people think and when they use the device, with the combination of us putting everything we have into them. And I think we'll keep putting more in, and the more we can get out from our customers, it's just a great cycle.
Stevie, you want to say anything?
I'm just so lucky, so excited to be part in an amazing company working on cutting edge hardware and inventing the future. And I think we're in a really exciting time in our lives of digital technology and computing evolving so rapidly. It's literally evolving and happening right in front of our lives. Month by month, new things happen. The way your life changes because of new technologies is just so exciting. And I mean, it really was what wakes me up, fuels me in the morning, and helps me, you know, helps us think about, you know, what's the future going to be like for us? I think it's exciting to be a part of that.
That's great. Well, good stuff. And I know some of the audience is going to want to pigeonhole you guys afterward with even more questions. So thank you very much for being here. We've been talking with Panos Panay, the head of devices at Microsoft, and Stevie Bathiche. He is a distinguished scientist in the hardware group at Microsoft. Thank you both very much for being on the show.
Yeah, okay. Thanks a lot for having us, man. It was a lot of fun.
Great. Thank you both.
Thanks.
And thanks to our studio audience. It's been great to have you both here. Until next week, from GeekWire.com in Seattle, I'm Todd Bishop.
And I'm John Cook.
We'll talk to you next time on GeekWire on Kyra Radio, 97.3 FM.